We will solve the second problem, that is stepped bar, and followed by that we will be solving bar of a tapered cross section area, and we will also try to understand how to simplify a complex model. Like if I compare this stepped bar and the tapered bar, there is a bit of a complexity in modeling this tapered bar. So let us start with solving a stepped bar, and followed by that, how do we approximate this tapering area into a stepped bar? So that we will be seeing when we solve that problem, that is bar of a tapered cross section. So let us start with stepped bar. So here you can see that we can model this structure as two elements, and one element will be having a cross section area whose cross section area is 900 mm square, and the another element will have a cross section area of 600 mm square. So as of now, we don't know how this cross section is, whether it is a rectangular or a circular. So if it is a circular, then a diameter will be given, and using that diameter we have to calculate the cross section area. If it is a rectangular cross section, then the dimensions of a length and breadth will be given. Using that we can calculate the area. Now as of now, we in the problem statement, the areas are directly given. The area of this element, the bigger element, is 900 mm square, and the area of a smaller element is 600 mm square, and the length of the element 1 is 600 mm, length of the element 2 is 500 mm, and Young's modulus of a material, that is steel, is given as 2 into 10 raised to 5 megapascal. And suppose if the value of the Young's modulus is not given, you should assume it to be approximate the Young's modulus based on the material. Like suppose if it is a steel, it is 2 into 10 raised to 5 megapascal. If it is aluminium, it is 70 gigapascal or 7000 megapascal. So that approximation, that properties you should know. Now we'll go for directly building of the finite element model in the answers. So in the previous class, we have understood that there will be three major steps while doing a analysis in the answers. So one is, in the preference, we will set what type of analysis we are doing, that is static or structural, structural, thermal, or CFD. So we will go for a structural, and I will say okay. And after that, we have to do a post pre-processing. In a pre-processing, we will be creating the elements, that is discretization of the structure, and we will be creating the material properties and section properties, and then we will apply loads and boundary conditions. So all these together steps forms a preprocessor. After that, we will solve the equation in a using a solution. This one, like we will run the load step, and from there the numerical analysis happens, and the software gives us a result. So once this process of solving is called as a solution step. The next third step is post-processing. Post means after solving, what are the results that we are going to see? So basically, pre-processor, solution, and post-processing. So we will carry it forward. Now, today I'll go to reference. Then I'll select on the structural and I'll say okay. So once that is done, I'll go to the pre-processor, and then I will define what are the type of elements. So I'll go to element type, click on edit, add, or delete. So here I should add elements. I will say okay, add. So here I can go for a link element, and under link element you can select a 3D finite strain 180 element, and I'll say okay. So once this is done, I'll say close. The element type is defined. Now I will go for a real constant. So in a real constant, I will select edit, add or delete. So here I have to assign the cross section area to the elements that I want to create. So I'll say add. So this to this element, I have to add a cross section area. So the cross section area for this one is in the PPT. If you see the PPT, he has given 900 and 600. So there are two cross section areas. In the sense, I should have a two real constant. So here it will be behind the screen. Sometimes this one goes behind the screen. So let us select that. So it will be just okay. If you don't get, you have to click on this. So it pops up again. So here the link has come back and I will assign a area as 900, and you see that the real constant is 1 here. Okay, so in the sense, it has created a real constant whose cross section area is 900 mm square. I'll say okay, apply or okay. Now I have to create another set, so wherein I have to create another cross section area, that is 600, and here you can write it as a 2, because already one set real constant is created. The second real constant is 600, so I'll write 2 and I'll say okay. So you can see that the two real constants are created. One is 900 and another one is 600. I'll say close. So once the real constants are defined, I'll go to the material properties. Under the material properties, click on the material models. And here you can see that a material model number 1 is created automatically. And I have to assign the structural properties. So in the previous class, we know that it is structural, linear, elastic, isotropic material. So under this, the Young's modulus is 2 into e raised to 5, that is 2 into 10 raised to 5 megapascal, and Poisson's ratio is 0.3. I'll say okay. So here I need not to create another material because the material is same. If two materials are there, I have to again go to the material and say new model. So as of now, we don't require. So I will close this window. After that, once the elements are defined, material properties are defined, real constants are defined, I have to build a now the model. So in order to create the model, I'll go to the create, and under that I'll go to the nodes. In under nodes, I will go to the in active CS mode, and here I told it is X coordinate, Y coordinate and Z coordinate, all are 0 now. So I will say apply. The second coordinate will be based on this element length. So now it is 600 mm and another one is a 500 mm. So in X direction, I have to put a 600 mm and I will create another node. So if you see that, you can see that a second node is created at a 600 mm. Now the third node is 600 plus 500, that is 1100. Because if you see the model here, this is 600. I have created a node here. Now I want to create this node. So 600 plus 500 is 1100. So I have to give 1100 in X direction and I will say okay. So when I say okay, you can see that the three nodes are created. Now, we should understand that the element that is connected between node 1 and node 2 has a different cross section area. And element which is connecting between 2 and 3 will have another cross section area. So in the sense, the attributes of the the element attributes are changing. So while creating that, you should be very cautious. So here there is an option called as a element attributes. Here in this case, I have to write it as a element type is link 180, material is only one. Okay, see here you have to be cautious, like real constant. There are two real constant. One is 900 mm and another one is 600 mm square. Okay, so I have to pick number one and I'll say okay. Now once that is done, I have to create an element. So using the element through nodes. So under this, I'll pick first node. You can see that the node is picked and you can see the count here. Count is one and maximum it is showing 20. So it doesn't matter. And minimum is one. The node number that you have picked is one. So the second node is also picked and I'll say okay. So once this is done, you can see that element one is created and it has a property of a steel and a cross section area of 900. So now if I create another element by clicking through the nodes, you can see that it will take the 900 only, but what I want is 600 mm square. So again, I have to go to the element attribute and here I have to select a link one, material is one, and here in a real constant, I have to select a element as a real constant as a two, because two in a two, there is a 600 mm square. So I'll say, okay. So once this is done, I'll click on the through nodes. I will pick this node and I'll say, okay. Now this has a cross section area of a 600 and this has a cross section area of a 900, but the material is same. So once this is done, I have to apply the loads and boundary conditions. To understand the loads and boundary conditions, just go to the PPT and you can see that the left hand side, it is fixed in all 6 degrees of freedom. And on the right hand side, force of a 500 kilonewton is applied. And one thing here you can notice that instead of a aluminum here, if you see this diagram, it is saying a Young's modulus is 0.7 × 10⁵, which is aluminum, but we are doing a for a step bar whose material is steel. So I have created only one material. So as an assignment, you can create another material with a 0.7 × 10⁵ Newton per mm square, and you can change the attributes and do the problem. So as of now, we have created only one material. So I will fix this left hand side. To fix that one, I'll go to the loads, go to define, and here under define loads, I will go to apply structural displacement and on nodes. I will pick this node and I will say okay. So yesterday we came to know that there are 6 degrees of freedom, 3 translation and 3 rotation. So I will fix all the degrees of freedom and I will say okay. And you can notice that triangular shape constraints are visible. That shows that it is fixed in all degrees of freedom. Now I will apply a load on this one. To apply a load on this, I have to click on this force and a moment. Again, click on this nodes and pick a node number 3 and say okay. So when you pick that one, the force is in fx direction, that is x direction. If you see this one, this is a x direction. So I will apply a force in a x direction whose magnitude is 500 newton. I will say okay. So now you can see that arrow mark is appearing. That means that a force is applied. So once the loads and boundary conditions are done, we have completed the pre-processing. Then the second step is I have to solve this problem. So to solve this problem, click on the solution. Under that, you can click on this solve and click on this current LS. So current LS means current load step. LS stands for load step. And I'll say okay. So once I say okay, you can see that it has solved and given a message that solution is done. So close this window also. and then you can go for a what to post processing. That is the final step. So under post processing, you click on the general post processing. Under that, you can go to the plot results, and under that, go to the deformed shape, and you can select a deformed plus undeformed. So deformed plus undeformed means without the load, and deformed means when the load is applied, it will undergo a deformation. So it will put both the image overlapping on one another. So again, you can see that the white dotted line is undeformed, and there is a small projection which is in a blue color that shows the that shows that it has undergone a deformation. And by what amount it has deformed is given by this. So maximum displacement is 0.00375 mm. So if you want to see the contours, go to click on this contour and go to the nodule solution, and you can click on this degrees of freedom and X component displacement and say okay. So you can see the displacements. Similarly, if you want to go for the stress distribution, so you can click on the stresses and go to the one mesh stress and say okay. So even the one mesh stress can be seen, or you can go for a different stresses. That is, let me put a X component stress. I'll say okay. So it will show the X component stress. So since it is axial, the stresses will be uniform throughout this. So you can either go for the nodal solutions displacement or the element solutions also. So if I want to click on the element solution, go to the element solution and click on this element one mesh stress. So it will show the stress. Okay. So once this is done, this completes the second problem. So I will click on this X component and I'll say the legend. So after this, you can go to the file, save as, and again you can go to the some folder and give a file name as a stepped bar, and dot db means database. So stepped bar dot db. So I will say okay. So this completes the second problem. So now let us go for the third problem. So in order to open a new file, I have to go to the clear and start new. I'll go to this. I'll say don't read a files, and I'll say okay. So it is asking whether to execute the previous commands. I'll say clear all. So now the whatever the file that was created, everything goes off and a new window appears. Now we'll continue with the third problem. So that is bar of a tapered cross section area. Now what is the difference between this model and this model? So they look ideally, this tapered bar is converted into a what, the stepped bar. So now there will be a some difference of the result, and also we know that finite element method is a approximation method. So what happened if it is if the part is something like this? So this is okay, means I am capturing the part accurately. Let me do it in a 3D model. So actually this is a 3D model of this, okay? But in a tapered bar, what happens? We will be approximating. Actually here there is a no material, but in tapered bar what happens if it is tapering? So this much of the material, like if it is tapering now, let me draw the tapering this one. So you can see that if I'm doing this problem stepped bar, here I'm accurately capturing all the sections. But in case of tapered bar, what happens? I will draw the tapering bar like this. And here what happens, this area I know, this area I know, but if I want to create a line element, so I have to split somewhere here, and the line I cannot give the varying area across the length of the element. So in order to simplify this tapering bar, what I have to do here is I have to approximate, like I will create a one element like this and another element something like this. So here in this case, what happens, this area we are ignoring it, or it is called as a approximation in a finite element method. So that's the reason what we say in a finite element method is the results that we obtain from a finite element method are approximate. Why? Because we are just ignoring this. But how to get accurate results without ignoring this? So in that case, what should I do? I have to split this tapering bar. Let me draw another tapering bar. Now instead of a two element, now here there are only two element, and this element has a cross section area measuring from here to here. This has a cross section area measuring from here to here. Now only there are two areas that are varying. But when I increase the number of elements, like I will consider a small steps like this. So from here to here one element, here to here one element, and from this position to this position one element. So as I increase the number of elements, I will be minimizing the error approximation. Okay, if I consider only two elements, I will be ignoring this much of the portion of the area and this much of the area. But when I take small elements, I will be ignoring very small amount of areas. So you can see that only small amount of areas are ignored. So in the sense, as if I want accurate results, I should go on decreasing the number of element size. In the sense, I should increase the number of elements instead of decreasing. Okay, so you know, by doing so, I will get a results more accurate. So we will try to consider only two elements, and we will try to approximate the areas. So to approximate the areas, what we have done, so the area of this bigger region is 1000 mm square, and the area of this one is 500 mm square. So I want some area here, so I will take a average of this. So what I have done, a1 plus a2 divided by 2, that is 1000 plus 500 by 2 equal to 750 mm square. So that I will consider it as a area at the center here. Again, to get this approximation area, what I will do, I will take this 1000 mm square plus whatever here, whatever I have created the area at the center, I will take the average of that two now. So 1000 plus 750, this 750 is the area at the center. So average of that is 800 750. Now to get the area of this one, again I will consider the smaller area plus 750 area from the center here. So it will be a 750 plus 500 divided by 2, that is 625 mm square. So now I am just approximating the areas, like the cross section area of the element 1 is 875 mm square, the cross section area of element 2 is 625, that is this portion. So we will be following the same procedure what we have followed in the problem 1, but only the thing here is we have taken the area by averaging it, or it is an approximation that we have done. So again, we will go to the software now. So there are two elements. So I will click on this and go to the structural, and I will say, okay. So in the preprocessor, I'll go to the element type, add element, say add element here, and under a link, it is 3D finite element. I'll say, okay. So close this. I'll go to the real constant. Under real constant, I will define two constant which are assigned to the element link 180. I'll say okay. And the first area is 875 that we have calculated. I'll say okay. And the second area is 625. So it is 625 mm square. I'll say okay. So you can see that two real constants are defined. Now I'll go to the material properties. Under material model, I'll click on the structural, linear, elastic, isotropic, and here in this one, I'll give a 2 into e raised to 5 megapascal. In a Poisson's ratio, I'll give it as a 0.3 and I'll say okay. So close this. So I'll go to the modeling of our nodes and elements. So I'll go to create nodes under nodes in active CS mode, and I'll give this as a 0 and I'll say okay. And the second node is at a 187.5. So I'll give 187.5 and I'll say okay. You can see that the second node is created. The third node is at a 375. So I'll give this as a 375 and I'll say okay. So three nodes are created. After that, create elements. So again, I have to go to the element attributes. Under this, link 180, material is 1, real constant is 1. I'll say okay. Click on this through nodes, select the first node and second node and say okay. Now to assign a attribute 2, that is, I have to change the real constant to 2 and I'll say okay. And again, I'll go to through nodes and click on the second node and third node and say okay. Now the two elements are created. After that, I have to define the loads. So under loads, you go to define loads, apply displacement. Under nodes, I'll click on this first node and say okay. And say all degrees of freedom. And again, you go to the force or a nodes. So click on this nodes, go to click three, node three, and I'll say okay. The force given on the structure is 1000 newton. So I will go to the FX and I will assign 1000 newton as a force. So you can see the arrow appearing indicating a force is applied. Now I'll go to the solution. Under solution, you want to go to solve current LS and say okay. The solution is done. So close this and then go for the general post-processing. Contour plots are a deformed shape and this one, deformed plus undeformed. Click on this one and again you can see the deformed and undeformed. Undeformed is a dotted white line and deformed is a extension in a blue color. So the maximum displacement is 0.00257. Now, if I want to see the contours, go to the nodal solutions, click on the DOF, degrees of freedom solution, under that X component of a displacement and say okay, and you can see the contours. Similarly, you can go for the stress plots. Okay. So if you go to the stress nodal solution, click on stress and the stress one message stress and click on okay. So this completes the third problem. So that is analysis of a tapered bar. So I will save it as tapered bar. So bar element. So .dv is database. So here we will stop the session. And if you have any queries, you can ask me.